some of the topics which were very, very important in this edition of Down to Earth. Let's focus on some conventional topics, some general topics. So the first topic was regarding climate impact. Now, China is one of the biggest greenhouse gas emitters, nearly double the greenhouse emissions as compared to United States. And we have also seen that the emerging nations like Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, Brazil are some of the nations where the generation of greenhouse gases is further higher. The next important topic we need to talk about is lightning. Now, lightning over the last two decades have increased significantly. There are very few institutes that are actually studying the phenomena of lightning. In India, it's just one team of scientists working at the Indian Institute of Tropical Meteorology in Pune who work on the issues of lightning. Also, it is believed that in the near future, nearly 10 to 25% cases of lightning strikes can increase. The next is Green Olympics. The Tokyo Olympics this time is considered to be the greenest game ever. You might wonder how, but the thing is very, very simple. The athlete beds have been created by recycled cardboards. Proper waste management has been ensured, and even the winning medals have been created from electronic waste. So definitely a Green Olympic. Now, these are some of the statistics which have been released, the total projected emissions and the reduction from the renewable energy and the recycling in terms of the carbon emissions. So here are some of the statistics that you must know, and definitely this has projected that nearly 2.73 million tons of carbon dioxide emission would be reduced by the efforts made for making this Olympic green. The next is the extreme poverty. Two of the nations, Nigeria and Congo, account for the maximum proportion of poverty and are among the top five nations. The next is Greenland is now suspending all its oil explorations and slowly moving towards greener ways, and it's mainly for the renewable energy, so shift in the renewable energy. In India, when we are focusing on the pandemic, it has been an important thing to understand that 3 million doses of DPT, which is diphtheria, pertussis and tetanus, were not administered during 2020. Now, if these doses of the normal vaccination cycle of a child are not administered, this can lead to significant rise of other diseases, the diseases which we are trying to control and eradicate. The next is the shield volcano. Shield volcano is a volcano that actually erupts slowly and keeps on moving like a slow lava. So in Ireland, the Ranges Peninsula, this volcano has been identified, and this is totally non-violent. It keeps on erupting and the lava keeps on moving slowly and spreading. So this is one of the examples of shield volcano which has been recently discovered. The next is wildlife trade. There has been a ban on the wildlife trade by many nations. For example, United Nations has banned the trade of dogs to curb rabies. China has curbed because of the monkey bee virus and animal to human transmission case which has been reported. Ghana has curbed the imports on wildlife because of the bird flu which has spread recently. And China has banned the feed additives which are coming globally. Also, to encounter the COVID situation, numerous countries are flooding in their funds for environmental control. US has flooded in nearly $3 trillion. However, globally, the other nations were able to contribute only $1.8 trillion. The next is understanding the Mekong River and the disruptions because of it. Now, Mekong River is one of the major rivers which flows through the nations of China, Myanmar, Laos, Thailand, Cambodia, Vietnam, and it's one of the major sources of livelihood and electricity in this area. Now, China recently partnered with Cambodia to create nearly 140 dams across the Mekong River. These dams have significantly affected the biodiversity of the region and the livelihood of nearly 60 million people who are living in the vicinity of the Mekong River. Now, the water levels in the Mekong have reached its lowest level in 2019 and therefore has become a significant cause of concern to the surrounding people. The next is Kandhamal turmeric. Kandhamal turmeric has a GI tag. GI tag indicates it's a geographical indicator saying that this place is specifically known for the growth of a specific product, and any exports or any use would be authorized only to this region. So it legally protects the crop or the original variety, and any unauthorized use needs to be curbed. So Kandhamal turmeric is a very, very important turmeric which is grown by the Kandh tribes. The land is prepared mainly for the rhizomes of the turmeric, and the initial saplings basically take nearly 10 months to grow. The rain meets most of the irrigation requirements, and then weeding is done only two times, one after 60 days after the sowing and other around 90 to 100 days after the crop is sown, and a few winter showers are good for it, but harvesting seasons usually start in the month of January and February. Under the Kasam project, which is the Kandhamal Apex Spices Association, it has the responsibility to promote the Kandhamal turmeric, or what we call as haldi, in the domestic market as well as the international market. Now, the most interesting thing about Kandhamal turmeric is the mulch which is used in the farms is prepared by the leaf litter of sal trees. So sal trees, which are grown locally in this region, provide a good mulching support to the Kandhamal turmeric, and it's a mutual ecosystem which is maintained. 2021 has been declared as year of variant by CDC and WHO, and this shows that there have been four variants of concern so far: alpha, beta, gamma and delta. Delta, the first cases were reported in India, and as of now 99% of the cases in UK and 73% of the cases in US are of Delta origin. Similarly, in Brazil we have the case ratio which is very, very less as of now, which is 29%, but we have other variants emerging in Brazil. Then the gamma was earliest discovered in Brazil, beta earliest discovered in South Africa, and alpha earliest discovered in UK. So these variants have been isolated at different places, and these four of the other variants which have been discovered are considered as variant of concern. Now, important to note, the Delta variant, it is believed, has 9 mutations in the spike protein in compared to the original Wuhan variant, and therefore has a very high transmittability rate as well as the reproduction rate. Globally, the vaccination levels have remained low. Only 25% of the global population has received one dose of the vaccination, which indicates a significantly low proportion. And the antibodies which have been analyzed in the blood samples of the people who have received one or two doses of the vaccine have been studied, and it is believed that people who have been fully vaccinated have 5 times lower levels against the Delta variant as compared to the previous variants. Also, numerous medication supports have been given. For example, ivermectin was one of the medicines which was initially talked about. It is an antiparasitic medication, but later on it was retrieved. However, Maharashtra has used it in continuation for the treatment purpose. Goa is using it for the preventive purpose. In UK, the treatment protocol has three steps. We call this as recommended, then we call it as conditionally recommended and consensus recommended. What is the difference? Recommended means the standard protocol for the treatment which is to be done in the normal case, and it is based on solid research. The next is conditional recommendation. Recommended, conditionally recommended are the interventions where partial research has been done, but the method is brought into account based on the advantages and disadvantages. The next is consensus recommended. Consensus recommended is where a panel of doctors thinks that the research does not exist as of now, and it is neither accepted nor rejected, but still it should be brought into interventions at the earliest. So these three levels have brought into a way through which the administration of the medications for COVID treatment can be done. Now the next is the pandemic of steroids. In our separate lecture on steroids, we have talked about the classification of steroids, the anabolic and the corticosteroids. Corticosteroids are also known as cortisols, which are used commonly for the treatment of the COVID-19 and many other disorders. However, anabolic steroids are mainly used by athletes for building muscles. Now, when we talk about corticosteroids, it generates an inflammatory reaction. The initial inflammatory reaction is small, but if the overdose is done for these steroids, it can actually lead to a significant loss, because these inflammatory systems, this inflammation can reach the body organs and other systems. WHO has given the guidelines for the use of steroids in COVID patients, and that should be safely administered only within 7 to 10 days. Now, however, despite of the WHO guidelines, the administration in India was much more than 7 to 10 days in numerous cases. It was up to 20 days as well. And even the dose was continuously increasing, which has brought into effect numerous side effects. What are the side effects? The side effect includes indigestion, sleep disorders, rise in blood glucose level, blood pressure levels, insomnia, depression. Then we have infections like chickenpox, measles, shingles, and important to note, when a steroid is administered, there cannot be sudden stoppage or abrupt stopping of the drug. There has to be a gradual decline in the amount of the drug which is being administered. Now, because of this steroid abuse, we have seen rising levels of blood glucose levels and rising fungal infections, and mucormycosis was one of the results. So there have been significant impacts of the steroids. As mentioned, these are synthetic. Our body also produces it in the adrenal region, but these steroids which are administered are synthetic, and it were first invented in 1939. This was when they were administered to the population in the region of Germany. Later on, the treatment cause which was used mainly for rheumatoid arthritis and even for various other disorders. For cancer treatment, steroids are administered. For high altitude pulmonary edema, which does not cause any infection but still has the recommendations for steroid. Significantly severe asthma has the indications for steroid to be administered. Now, overall, the study of WHO says that when steroids were administered, the mortality per thousand was brought down from 415 to around 328. So steroids did had an impact in lowering down the mortality rate, but still If the prescription is not proper and the administration is not correct, it can lead to its own side effects. The next is aeroponics. Now, aeroponics is a concept where air is used for growing the plants. This was first when the Edzuki beans were grown in the microgravity environment. Later on, NASA did various researches to grow plants in space, and this project got successful. Some of the species like lettuce, melon, tomatoes, mint, mustard, green, thyme, basil were actually grown using aeroponics. So what works here? The roots are actually hanging in the air. They are not into the soil. No soil is required. And a spray of nutrient is done to keep the roots moist. So charcoal is kept in the container below to absorb any extra moisture for the plants. Now, what is the nutrient solution made of? Nutrient solution is made of nothing but 1 tablespoon of vermicompost with 1 liter of water, and this is further diluted based on the requirement. So that is the only thing which is required. Now, what are the core benefits of aeroponics? The core benefits are the water level, the water usage can reduce up to 90%. No water is required, very less amount of water is required. Soil is not required, so soil use is eliminated. Fertilizer use can reduce to up to 60%. Again, significantly important. Pesticides by all means would be eliminated. No use of pesticides. And therefore, aeroponics is considered to be one of the very, very successful and very, very better practices as compared to other methods. If this becomes possible, all our developments which had gone in line with the Green Revolution would go primitive, and we would have a new generation of agricultural developments and agricultural research which had been witnessed. Now, US-based company AeroFarms is one of the companies which has converted the whole of the rusted warehouse in Newark, the suburb of New York, into the walls which has green saplings, and the company has become the world's biggest vertical farm which can harvest nearly 1,000 tons of greens every year, and that's the capacity of this farm. Similarly, there have been companies like Fujitsu, which has been a company of Japan, which is trying to create countries like Singapore self-sufficient in food grains, and the food production increased from 10% to 30% by 2030. So significant increase in the food production in Singapore has been witnessed with this technology. If this technology can be brought to India, definitely the quality of the soil would become better, because we would use less of fertilizers, and with aeroponics, even in the urban areas, the crop cultivation can become successful. However, the initial cost of this project is higher. The next is the wool industry. Now, wool industry in India, despite the fact that we have the world's third largest number of sheep population, from around 74.26 million sheep that are present in the country, there has been an increase of nearly 14% in the last 7 to 8 years, and we indicate that our population is significantly high when it comes to sheep. But when it comes to wool, we are importing wool from initially we are importing sheep from US, but this variety actually had a very low survival rate in India. Now, the sheep which was imported was Rampurne, and this is the sheep which actually had a very low survival rate. So we shifted from US model to Australia, and now we imported a lot of merino sheep in India. And these merino sheep in India are basically spread across various states. Still, we are not self-sufficient. Our production is very, very less as compared to our consumption. Our consumption is 3 times our production. Again, in Rajasthan, Bikaner area is the area which had 10 years back, which was the world's biggest mandi for wool. Now, the situation has changed and it's no more the world's big Asia's biggest wool market, but it is now trading with wool and grain as well. Now, what is the main variety that is produced in India? Chokla and Magra are the two wools which are produced, and both of these are superior quality used for carpet production. But these qualities are coarse in nature. They are not as fine as the merino wool, and therefore they are not used for production of clothes. They are mainly used only for carpet manufacturing. With more of synthetic carpets coming in, this industry is slowly declining. Also, the indigenous wool has suffered at the hands of the machine-made long stapled wool. The the sheeps which were cultivated, which were basically taken care of mainly for wool, are now used for meat production. The pastures have been declining significantly, and these are some of the reasons why the wool industry has suffered a setback in India in the last few years. The next is the monsoon forecast and IMD. Every year before the monsoon, there is a forecast which is being given by the IMD, Indian Meteorological Department. However, this year, the monsoon forecast was not up to the mark. The time of sowing the crops could not be properly explained, and the history of predictions suggested otherwise. There are usually three types of forecast. One is the long range, which is for the entire monsoon season. The extended forecast, which is up to 10 days to a month. Then we have short forecast for 3 days and a medium range forecast for 3 to 5 days. Now, this season we have witnessed cyclones before the start of monsoon season, which is a very, very rare phenomena. It has been a constant phenomena, however, since 2019. But before that, there were no cases where cyclones are witnessed before the onset of monsoon in India. So, extreme weather conditions are now witnessed. The weather conditions are highly dynamic in nature, with floods, heat waves, lightning strikes, wildfires, significant amount of heavy rainfalls. The weather changes are not actually predicted very well. Now, what happens? What is a systematic bias that occurs when IMD declares a forecast? Now, this forecast explains how much rainfall would occur in a region. However, if the forecast is not in line with the actual thing that has happened on the ground, what we call this as a systematic bias. Now, based on this systematic bias, IMD further adjusts its readings. Now, when the IMD adjusts its readings and the variations based on the error which was in the actual and the predicted model, this further deteriorates the model in the case that the predictability becomes further unreliable, and therefore the reliability of the forecast decreases. The second important thing is we do not have a proper understanding of the impact of sea surface temperature on monsoon winds, and because of that, the rising temperatures of the sea surface, which have resulted into global warming, which have been rising because of the global warming, are difficult to study and not properly accounted in the forecast studies. So forecasting is increasingly becoming difficult with variability in the weather conditions, extreme weather phenomena and extreme events, monsoon becoming much more variable. So new methods for analysis and new technology needs to be brought into account. So those were some of the important topics that we have discussed. We would be covering Down to Earth every fortnightly. Stay tuned for the updates, and the handouts for the same would be available at Examrace current affairs section, the links for which are available in the description. Have a wonderful day ahead.